Welcome to Talk Art. I'm Sally Rain, and I'll be your host as we delve into the world of the artist and the art that's all around us. Talk Art is sponsored by the Silicon Valley Open Studios. During the first three weekends in May, hundreds of local artists open their studios to the public. For more information, you can go to the website svos.org. Our guest, Nance Wheeler, is a San Francisco Bay Area mixed media artist, and she creates beautifully intricate paintings and is going to demonstrate some of her processes today. And she is also the producer of Talk Art, and together we have sponsored and created wonderful shows for over 40 artists in the local area. So welcome, Nance.
Thanks, Sally.
Yeah, so tell us a little bit about your work. Why don't you describe what you do?
Well, my current work is based on abstracted science. It's kind of a combination of old science and new art techniques. The old is really early technical drawings and traditional drafting techniques. And the new is digital collage and the very modern medium of acrylics.
Well, very interesting. Tell us how you got started in this direction.
Well, you know, I was rummaging through my studio and I came across some of my old drafting tools. And it brought to mind some ancient drawings that I had seen and had a chance to study. And there's a real artistry to those drawings, which is kind of lost today because everything's computer-aided design now. And so I realized when I was thinking of that, that in my sketchbooks, there was a long-running theme of technology and change. And I thought, you know, I need to kind of pursue that, and these are some of the results.
So how did you happen to have old drafting tools that you dug up?
Well, I won't say I'm old, but they did still have classes in that when I was in school.
Yeah, and what did you study?
I studied engineering, and I actually took some courses in the history of engineering.
Oh, so like some of Leonardo da Vinci's engineering drawings, things like that?
Yes.
Is that what you're talking
yes.
about?
Yeah.
Oh, those are beautiful.
They are.
Yeah, so you brought some images, some JPEG images in. Why don't we start with those and take a look at them, and then you can describe your process.
All right. A lot of these early pieces are based on drawings from an astrolabe, which is an ancient navigational tool. And what I do is I collage on some pieces, and then I begin using traditional drawing techniques, compass and straight edge. And then I highlight certain points to bring out certain figures. And you can see there's kind of a rhythm to these drawings. Now here on the next one, you can see I once again highlighted some of the figures, but I've also added in little people. There's little stick figures in there hanging in and around. And it's kind of bringing it into the realm almost of illumination, such as illuminated manuscripts, where you add to the context of the whole thing by bringing in new elements.
Really interesting. And the lines are so precise. Very nice.
This is also based on the astrolabe. And this is bringing that concept a little further. And you can see it's kind of flattening out, becoming much more like manuscript illumination.
Yeah, and you use some of the gold to highlight it as well.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Now, this one, you can see the conversation is changing, and it's more about age. I'm not trying to recreate the look of age, but to have a conversation, so to speak, about it, where we're bringing in the changing of the paper, the fading of the inks, the different rates that the inks fade, and kind of the designs that they create when that happens. This, once again, is about that conversation of age. And you can see it's got, in the background, there's a grid of overlapping circles. Now, this goes much further into the age concept, and it's less about the forms and much more about the sheen and reflection of the surface, and how some things become quite bold because they don't age, and other things age almost to just a faint shadow.
That one looks more like a technical, old technical drawing to me.
Yes,
as well.
Yes, that one's very much based on the technical drawing because I wanted it to be all about the surfaces. Using collage elements, we can just take out of the picture the drawing and begin to look at the surfaces.
Well, very nice. So you do all of that with modern tools and technology.
I use both traditional tools and modern tools.
Yeah, let's see what you have. What is this?
This is an astrolabe, and as I said, those drawings were based on an astrolabe.
And what exactly does it do?
This can tell you a lot of things. It's like an early analog computer. It can tell you, if you know what time it is, you can tell you your latitude.
Wow.
If you know what latitude you're at, it can tell you what time it is. It can tell you the elevation of things through triangulation. It can help you identify where the sun is going to be with respect to the moon, with respect to the Earth.
Right? And where did you get this?
I made this in college.
Wow.
And full disclosure, I had a partner. my partner did a lot of the drafting work, and I did most of the brass work.
Very nice.
And you can see on the back, this allows you to sight, so you sight your star or your planet to get your bearings. So they use this.
And very precise. I mean, there are tiny, very thin lines that you probably can't see on the television, but everything is perfectly measured. It's an amazing tool that they created.
It's amazing the work that you can do with a compass and a straight edge.
Wow. So what are you going to show us first?
So first I'm going to do an underpainting. I start every painting with an underpainting. You can't always... It may not always be obvious. Some of them are very obvious.
Right.
Some of them are less obvious. But it's always there, and it adds an element of texture and depth to the canvas. And I always have a plan. I mean, it looks rather random, but there's actually a plan as to where things go. And
so what is this that you're putting on the canvas now?
This is a liquid acrylic. I actually use some that are called inks or high flow. They have different names, but you can actually bring down some of the fluid to a very, very liquid state. And I'm diluting it somewhat in order to make it more workable because I want to soften the edges. I don't want hard edges in most cases on this.
So this is almost like a wet-on-wet watercolor technique.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very similar. And you can see my plan on the other canvas, so I'm just trying to get, you know, a little bit close to that. And now, you don't have to be limited to one color. You can do it in layers, and I always do layers. Almost never get it... Okay, and this is the problem with acrylics is they can get dry. So sometimes you got to just wing it. and of course,
this is great. And what tool are you using to spread it?
This is a palette knife. It's just a standard palette knife, and I use palette knives, brushes, sticks, whatever creates the edge that I'm looking for. Like, I'm going to dilute that just a little bit more on some of the edges because I want the edges to be a little softer on the outside. I'll leave them a little harder in the areas that I'm going to, in the areas that I'm going to have my focal point. So there you are. Now, that'll have to dry.
Yes.
Obviously. And I'll probably put another layer because, as you see, I've diluted it down, and I'm going to need to add more layers in order to get the value contrast that I need for the painting.
Okay, so now we have some other images that you want to take a look at to show some more examples of your art. So let's take a look at those now.
Now you can see this one's a little bit different from the earlier ones. It's got kind of a cleaner look to it, so we're talking less about age and we're more about space and instrumentation. We've still got the instrumentation effect, but you're beginning to see a lot more space in this coming series. As you can see, this one, I like to think of this as, I call it arriving alpha. And to me, this is what a space map looks like, right?
So you mean a map of outer space?
Outer space,
okay.
Right? So I'm going planet to planet. Right. This is what my path looks like. This is what my travel looks like. Because again, you know, we're talking about the conquest of space,
right,
and time and the physical world. And so, you know, if I look in my mind, I will want to be in outer space traveling from planet to planet and seeing new things.
Beautiful.
This is called Leaving Beta. It's a companion piece to the one just before it. And you can see, again, we're outlining paths from point to point, the circles. And this is called Jetson's Homecoming because if you think about the 50s and 60s, we were just raring to get into space, right? And, you know, we had, everything was, you know, about space. Well, at least to me. I mean, I was a child, so very, very young child, of course. but, you know, we were so anxious to get onto space, and these motifs remind me of that. And to me, it's full of enthusiasm.
Oh, yeah.
Right? We were anxious. We were ready to go.
But still using the slide rule.
In fact, my uncle worked for NASA,
right,
and he was using a slide rule. Yeah,
exactly.
And this is called Jetson's Vacation, right? It's a companion piece to the earlier one. And again, it's like, you know, we're out there going planet to planet and having a blast.
I'm ready. Okay, so you have some more demonstrating to do on this piece. So that piece has dried and it's become this.
It's
and
become
what do you
this.
Do next?
And I've put multiple layers on this. And so what I'm going to do on this is to draw. Now, I want to show you, I'm not going to use it, but I wanted to show, this is a traditional drafting pen. And you just dip it in ink and the surface tension holds the ink in the pen.
Wow.
And it draws a beautiful line. But because I'm using a canvas and because the lights can make the acrylic dry, I'm going to use a marker instead.
In your paintings, you use that tool.
I use both.
Okay.
I use both, depending on the quality of the line I want.
Okay.
They give a slightly different quality of line. So this will give a harder... this is in the ink, so it'll give a nice black line.
Right.
With that, I can pick up any color that I have available that's liquid enough. Now, I have a design pre-set out, so I...
So do you have a sketch that you work from?
I typically work in stages, so I'll do thumbnails and then evaluate what that looks like afterwards and see if I want to change that. So I don't do a super detailed drawing, but I may have a variety of sketches that I'm working from.
So this is how you get those beautiful, wonderful circles.
Yeah. And this is a fairly simple design because, of course, we're going to try to do it within the limits of television. And I want it to match the next canvas that I've already prepared. So,
looks like you've used a compass a lot. Using a compass is not as easy as it looks.
You do have to plan. And if I'm doing an ad hoc line, I have to turn it around the entire circle before I lay the pen down on the paper, because you'd be surprised how many times it's not quite in the right place.
Oh yeah.
I actually make it transcribe the entire circle before I finish. And there we go.
That's great. So these circles then will become part of a larger design then.
These will become part of a larger design. And what I'll probably do, or what I had already decided to do on this one, is that I will fill in some of the circles, leave some of them blank, you know, and I'll probably do it in a translucent fashion so that I can still see a lot of the underpainting, even through the painted parts of the circle.
So how would you get it to be translucent?
It's a question of, colors have different amounts of translucency to start with,
right,
just the pigment itself. But you can also add medium to it. I add, you know, if I want to bring something down to highly translucent, I'll add a lot of medium.
Right.
If I want to do less. And you have to practice a little bit because the medium is an opaque white when you start.
Right.
So you have to know, you have to have done enough to know how much that's going to dilute it down.
Right. And so. It's, you can't really see what it's going to look like when it dries.
You can't see the final, but you can have a pretty good idea.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
So, and the more experience you have, the easier it is.
Right.
Right.
So you brought some more images
yes.
of another series of art. So let's
yes.
take a look at those.
So as you can see on this series, we now see a lot of the underpainting. And it's because the conversation has shifted once again, right? Now it's a lot more about space, and it's actually about the spatial quality. So we go back and forth with the spatial quality and measuring space. And here I'm actually looking at the spatial quality and saying, you know, it's called finding because it's like, where are you in space?
Interesting. And then by space, you mean how your circles are related to each other as well as outer space?
As well as, you know, where are we? I mean, you know,
right.
if you had no system of saying where you are, where would you be, right? What are you relating it to? Because it's all relational. This one also is called searching, because it's like, you know, how do you find where you are, and you haven't quite established that. So it's about the struggle of finding where you are.
Interesting. Lots of arrows pointing you in different directions.
Right. And now this is shifted again, right? Even though it's quite similar, it's in the same vein, but now we're beginning to talk about the technology, the processes that you're using to arrive at that answer to space.
Interesting.
You know, that answer of how do you calculate where you are.
So how do you see that in this picture?
I see that by the arcs that come across. And there's a lot of detail there, and it brings to it. Now, this, again, the conversation has shifted. It's shifted back to the instrumentation. This particular one is about, the instrumentation where you're, the astrolabe, where you're finding it, but you're looking at the instrumentation itself as it relates to each other in this painting versus just a solo, I stand on my own instrument. And this one's a little different. It's called Lead to Gold, and it's talking about understanding the physical world.
Right.
You know, today we think, oh, lead to gold, ha, 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 right? But back then, it was a legitimate hypothesis.
Right. The alchemists would study how to create gold
yes.
from lead.
And if you think about it, technology moves forward by very creative people making crazy hypotheses. And then looking for experimental proof that works. Because if you think about it, I mean, think about black holes and the curvature of time and space. I mean, who would have ever believed that, right? It sounds crazy if you didn't already know some of the experimental background that goes into it. So if you think about it, these people were struggling with those same questions.
Right.
You know, can I do this, right?
Exactly. Chemistry worked that way.
Yeah. And this particular painting is about the relationship of the sun and the moon and the earth. Which side faces which, and where do they eclipse, and you know how are they relating to each other? Because you know we're a little triad there, so.
Right, and so much measurement has gone into figuring that
out. I know.
Out.
It was a very important problem.
Right.
You know, early in man's history. And this is about, you know, on the surface, it's about the sun's rays and measurements and analyzing, but really it's about complexity. It's about the complexity of technology. I mean, things that we think are trivial today were very complex back then, and they had to do a lot of things all by hand. And part of the reason we think things are trivial today is because we have machines that do all those calculations
right.
for us.
Well, yeah.
I mean,
if we
honestly,
didn't have the machines,
you know,
we'd be lost.
If we didn't have GPS, I think a few of us couldn't get home, right? So we rely a lot on those machines.
Right.
And so it's a very big challenge for every generation.
Right.
That there's a complexity that they have to deal with. So
you have another canvas here.
I have another canvas here. It's another step. And what I'd like to do is make some marks. And it's just a question of highlighting. What I have here is a very small nozzle on a, on a bottle of very fluid stuff. And it's working, so that's
good.
A good step. It's a 5 millimeter nozzle, and it's essentially the tip of a mechanical pencil.
So you're not going to use a brush?
No, I'm going to use this as my mark maker. And if you think I'm like really nervy, just remember, in acrylic, you can if the bottom is dry and the top is fresh, you can usually wipe it off.
Ah.
So if you want to.
As long as you have something painted underneath.
So, yeah, so long as it's closed, right?
So what is the process? Which process are you thinking of here for space and relational?
This is almost like a map, right? You're identifying points. And at some point, you just, you forget the picture. I mean, you forget the, at some point you leave the one side of your brain and you move to the other side of the brain and you say, where's this picture going and what can I do with it? And that's what I'm doing now.
So the very tight circles and the compass and all of the tools that you use, now you're going, creating the more artistic side of what are you thinking? Where are you reaching?
Exactly. I mean, there's a certain point where it becomes nonverbal.
Yes.
And you're thinking with your creative side, and it's about the picture. It's less about all the planning that went into it.
Right.
You know, planning is very important, but at a certain point, you step away from the plan and you do what's right for the picture. And I would have to let this dry at this point and then continue on, because I'm one of those people, if I work too long in a wet canvas, I get my sleeve or my finger in it. So
yep.
That's one of the beauties of acrylic, is it will dry for you.
Yes, and it dries very quickly, too.
It does dry, especially
in the summer.
Does the liquid
acrylic dry as quickly as the thicker, heavier body?
Yeah, it'll dry. Well, technically there's differences, but much more to the point is how much humidity is in the air that day and what's the airflow. So it's more about how thinly did you apply it and how thickly did you apply it.
Excellent. So tell us a little bit about where we can see your art.
Well, I'm at Gallery House in Palo Alto, and I display my art there. And I'm also a member of Silicon Valley Open Studios. So every year in May, I do Open Studios along with some friends of mine.
So tell us a little bit about some of the benefits of being an SVOS artist.
Well, I've met a lot of people in open studios, and that's a great benefit. But one of the reasons I really continue to do it is that people come and sit down and talk to you about your art. I mean, you really get to meet people who are interested in your art face to face. They have an opportunity to come to a beautiful setting with a lot of art and come and look at different pieces and ask questions and learn about it. So.
Excellent. So you brought some other tools with you, some of the older tools that
yes.
you use. I'd love to see those. I'm very interested. The Astrolabe is just a phenomenal piece of equipment and the detail. So what
this
do you
is
have?
An old drafting set. You can see there are a lot more pieces.
Let me see.
So you can see there are different sizes, and they're short because they have different attachments that can go into it. But you can see these are very fine tools that went through a lot of use, and they were very, very precise. And if you want to make larger circles, one is you can get an extender. You can get an extender that goes on your compass.
On the compass itself.
Right. Or you can get what's called a beam compass, which is basically a compass which is a long bar.
Oh, so if you wanted to do a much larger canvas, you could do it with that?
But if you're on a budget and you're only making arcs, you can try and just use string or, I guess it's over here actually.
Yep.
You can use, this is what I use. So if I'm making arcs and I want them to be large arcs, I'll put my marker, whatever the mark is, on this end. I'll anchor this side, and then I'll draw my arcs just like that. I mean, that's a very traditional way to make a large arc.
Right.
It's hard to make the entire circle like that.
Right.
You run into your arm. But for large arcs, it's perfect, and it's as close to free as you're going to get.
That's great. So what do you see for your future? I know you've done some beautiful landscapes. I have one in my own collection, and now you're working on the space and the technical side of it. Are you going to continue on creating more of these?
Yeah, I will continue with these. And I've really spent a lot of time on spatial, and I'm probably going to move into time more. And so the question is, you know, it's a whole new set of instrumentation, a new type of drawings, and a lot of different collage elements that I can work with. But also, how do you portray time,
right,
the passage of time? And, you know, so those are interesting questions for me. And, you know, I worked in the semiconductor industry, so there's a lot of very graphic-looking items if you work in that industry. So there's plenty to work with there.
Plenty to work with. Well, thank you so much for being on Talk Art, and thank you also so much for producing our show. You do a wonderful job, and everyone appreciates how much you do.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.